Well, hello again. This is Philip Steiger at thebestready.com with another Daily Dose with PD Howler. And in today's session, this is going to be pretty short because I have to rush out soon to get to Comic-Con. So one thing I want to quickly cover here are two more brushes, particle brushes, and then a whole set of tools in Penny Paint. Okay, particle brushes we may have seen already a little bit in prior lessons. It opens up, and there's actually a shortcut for that I, right? Shortcut I. I call that I for incredible. Incredibly addictive, at least. What this does is it shoots particles right from the brush. So if you start painting right here, right, dragging the mouse, you see it shoot particles going down. If you zoom out, or if you put it at 100%, the full regular size, you see that here too. If you want, you can change the gradients. Right. If you want, you can change the gravity. This is right now 0.9. If we give it a negative gravity, it will grow upwards. Okay, so let's say we grab one of the gradients that have more of a greenish color. Right. Now, what's happening here is that these particles are shooting out in any sort of direction. At the initial speed, we can set that a little bit bigger. Right. And you can also change what their final velocity is. So they go a little bit farther away, and you can change perhaps if they even split. You know, particles that have a certain lifespan, you can set the lifespan, and if it's very short, then there'll be little tufts like that. You can also have them split, so one or two times, which means they end up growing more into bushes and branches and so on. There is a shading you can enable that will enable the dark side to be the bottom side to be darker. Can see here the bottom half of it, any particles that grows downward is going to be dark. And then also what's actually being rendered along those particles. Okay, by default it's just a line, you see the style here, but you can have it in other styles. You can have it line plus alpha, and that means basically it's doing the selection mask for you. You see the marching ants right after that, and that's really, really powerful. But it doesn't stop there. You can also you know, when you do something like this, you can pick it up into the custom brush just like that, right? So use the selection as your brush. Then when you clear it and disable the particles, you now have this brush, this image in your brush as a transparent, with a transparency mask. You can see that here, stored, the image will show you the plaid pattern behind it. All right, so that's a very quick way to create assets and, you know, foliage effects for any sort of deep forest backgrounds with vines and trees and rocks, and you want some moss and other stuff growing over. There's lots of presets here. You see the garland effect, for instance, that you could have grow along a particular you know, a tree or along the side of a house or something like that. Many different presets. These are actually yet another style. These are shrinking lines, and they can also be shrinking lines plus, which means plus alpha. So when you do something like this here, it will also do the selection mask for you there as well. Right. Let's control D to get out of that. And there is a few more styles. There's the brush style, which means whatever your normal brush is, let's throw that along the particles. Right. So if I grab something like a very sparse, I think I have some very sparse grass here somewhere. Or maybe not, but I can do so. I can reduce the number of, you know, normally it's like this, and I can reduce, first of all, I can change the style to do shrinking lines, all right, but much smaller size to begin with, so it's very thin. And then I can have them a little bit initially faster at the initial velocity, and then even faster towards the end. So they come up pretty high. I can also have fewer of them, let's say 33, and a maximum of 11 of them at any moment. So you can have very sparse outlets like these. Of course, this doesn't have to necessarily be used to create grass. This could be little spider webs. This could be all sorts of other fictitious art. And you know, combine that with where is it there? Oh yeah, here with the symmetrical painting. Combine that with vertical or other symmetry. It'll open up all sorts of new avenues. And then of course, if you, let's say if you grab a filter and go do a convolution, like a color Sobel edge, all sorts of other really funky stuff are possible here with this. Alright, so let's disable the mirror for a second so we see exactly what's happening. You can change, you can use the mouse velocity as well, so if you go slow, if you go fast, it may look a little bit different. In these particular ones it doesn't look too much different, but if you load something like Baddy Grass, maybe that will be, you know, how far the grass shoots out will be a function potentially of how fast you move the mouse. So if you go slowly like this here, it's kind of tame, it's kind of lame, it's kind of slow. Old grass, baddy grass. And then if you go with the velocity, the mouse velocity really high, the moment you do a little tick, a little shootout, you'll see some sort of tufts coming out like that, right? Some boom, some explosives there. And that's actually something you can also use for explosions and, you know, smoke trails and stuff. So I mean, it's a full particle system right in the brush, and you can even use stroke player to play that against an animation and have the particles grow over time with Hancock mode, for instance. So there's a variety of other possibilities to use that. I encourage you to experiment and play with that. Now I wanted to also show you another type of brush. Let me disable this here. There's, by the way, bristle brushes here. We'll cover that some other time. But particle brushes is one thing, and the other thing I wanted to show you is Penny. Now Penny is a plugin, an add-on, and it's included with the PD Pro distributions, but you can also find it as an add-on to PD Particles and add it to PD Artist or the earlier versions. We've done some updates over time. So if you go to Penny Paint, it's basically a paint program within the paint program. Right? What it really does is it loads the current image that you had down there, it loads it into another paint application. This is called Penny. It's a spline-based paint engine. Now I'm covering this quickly here today because it's Comic-Con time right now in San Diego, and there is a lot of interest in how to draw some good quality line art, you know, cartoons, comics, and that's what the strength is of Penny. Penny is a spline-based paint engine, and you typically wouldn't use it to do much of that particle brush and realistic clouds and backdrops and, you know, all the matte painting. You would use it instead with just four brushes. It gives you four brushes here. All right, so one thing you can do is clear what you currently have there, and you have a first brush, and that one's a pen. So, and in all cases, they are anti-aliased and interpolated, spline interpolated. So they're pressure sensitive also, and you can set the maximum size. And so if you press lightly, you get thin lines. If you press harder, you get fat lines. That's with your tablet. Of course, it requires you have a tablet, like a great Wacom tablet or something like that, whatever you can afford. I mean, it's not much more expensive as an entry-level tablet to go with, you know, like $60 or $50 or $80. It's, if you spend ever money on a gamer's mouse, a high-end mouse, you probably spend about the same amount of money as you could for a tablet. And many of these tablets actually come with a mouse on top, a wireless mouse on top of it. Anyway, back to this here, we have a triangular color selector here. We can set the size. So this is for quick, very clean line art. Now it's a little bit kind of choppy on my system because I'm doing a print of a couple of images for Comic-Con, so my poor old system here is kind of chugging along. Let's see what else we got there. We got the opacity you can change. So if you go very thin, it's not doing much until you go over it again and again. So you can actually also do some nice coloring and you know, painting and filling in some colors. Then there is the press parameter here. Let's get the opacity full. So that one kind of simulates if you have a fibrous, a pen with fibers, and you press harder, and you know it's kind of soft, almost like airbrushing. You get the step, the distance between the dabs, and that of course makes it even more erratic or soft. There is the step, there's that, there's paper texture. Whatever your current paper texture is here, it will use that as well, if you want. And I don't think I have a good one enabled. Oh no, there's one down there. So you can go back to the paper textures here in Dog Waffle. At the same time, this one here is running by its own. It's basically a separate application, you know, and that's the great advantage of Dog Waffle. It runs as an ActiveX server, and you can have other programs run side by side at the same time. They'll find their own core on a multi-core system. And that was actually highlighted in a review by Maximum PC many years ago, is that the architecture of Dogwaffle is interesting from the software architecture point of view in many ways. One of them is that if you have a multi-core system, the main app will run on one core and any plugins will typically find its way on another core, so it's well balanced. And it does really work beautifully. So the paper textures, you can go here and perhaps grab something like a canvas or dinosaur skin, and let's keep that there. So if I use that, I don't know if I need to load that. Get paper, there you go. So now I can go and paint with that, and you see a little bit of a texture pattern there too. Let's put a little bit more pressure on that. Let's give it kind of a green yellowish tint, maybe a little bit more on the reddish. There you go. So you see that pattern of the paper texture showing through there as well. And you can have it a little bit more intense if you want. Alright, so that's this one brush. Look at all the stuff we've done already just with this one brush. And there is much more. There are four more in Penny. This one here is kind of a water brush. So that one, let's do without paper initially and normal defaults kind of things. That one is going to be quite useful if we ever get to work. Opacity should be probably full. There you go. So that one's kind of a water paint, very watery surface. But it's interesting because it kind of merges wherever you went over it. So, you know, if you do something like this and then go right over it, it kind of bridges, it opens up the barriers. Now, if you do another one on top of that, it'll be as if it's layer, like a another layer of transparent watercolor or whatnot. So right there, there's a tremendous power to create some fancy anime-style illustrations or letterings and words and whatnot. And then there is, of course, also the ink. We do a lot of ink and paint work, paint and ink and sketching and coloring. And so the ink tool is yet another one here that behaves well the way you expect for ink and pressure, and you know, all of it is fully spline interpolated, anti-aliased, and what did I say? Oh yeah, smoothed, pressure sensitive, paper still there as well. And then there's a gel. That's perhaps my favorite, the gel. Alright, so let's go gelling here. Let's get the pressure, the opacity full, step relatively small. Let's start with something like this, okay? And then let's see what happens if we reduce the opacity. It's kind of a semi-transparent mode here. How about the step and the paper? Combine that. So, you know, imagine you take a tube, like toothpaste, and you push it out there. Well, maybe without the paper. Maybe just a little bit of granularity. Okay. There's probably some baking soda in that tube of of toothpaste. There you go. Opacity, let's put it full. Sure. Oh yeah, that's the one I was looking for. I remember having really a blast with some of this here. But there's too many options to remember all the combinations. Anyway, I invite you to play with Penny Paint, another great feature. There's even more. There's all the different drawing modes here to explore. And that will be certainly a great addition to your drawing, because, you know, basically what the way you probably will use it is to create some sort of a outline with this, right? And then once you've done your outline and you want to go ink it or add some backdrops or other stuff, you simply quit the application, you close it, or you can, I think you can send stuff back. There you go, there's some arrows here. Get image from Dogwaffle or send stuff to Dogwaffle. So, I mean, if you forgot or if you modified it on the Dogwaffle side, you can grab the current image from Dogwaffle. You can do your drawings like this. And notice the one in Dogwaffle doesn't have that face yet, right? So, but when you send it over to Dogwaffle, or if you quit, if you close the application, it will do the same thing. It will send that last version into the Dogwaffle buffer. And then so at that point, you can move on and do some other stuff with that. Alright, and that's it for today. Quick break. I'm gonna head over to Comic-Con, and perhaps I'll have some images to show you a little bit later. Alright, have a great day. See you again on another episode of The Daily Dose.